Put it down or cut it to half. Quarters of tenths or something. Oh, those are nice. You know, I have a weakness for pastry, but I'm not supposed to eat sugars.
Oh, no.
But I eat it, you know, and when occasion offers, there are exceptions, you know, the times when you do. How did you make this a Chinese character, by the way?
I Xeroxed yours and reduced it in order to fit with that.
Because it looks like the same one.
It is.
And there is something, well, the Chinese believe very much in the hand, the stroke,
the
expression. There was a good touch there. And I actually gave you a copy of the one that I like best, because there's a big difference, even doing my own different versions of that. Mm-hmm. You know, it's poetry. You know why? You understand all that? Like, this is a mouth.
Oh, yes.
There are words coming out of the mouth. The third stroke is a bit bigger than the other two, for some reason, but that's aesthetically right. One, two, three. One. From the mouth, words. So a mouth with those things means word in Chinese, or words. They don't, singular or plural is the same. And then this conk conk like that is a court with something in it. The whole sign is court, is a court, the royal court. Court word. Court words. Poetry is court words. Last Sunday we had this kind of talks about courtoisie, courtesy. Courtesy is courtoisie, is the behavior of the court. Originally, old people were barbarians, ruffians, but in the court before the king, you behave better. Mm-hmm. And from that developed the idea of courtesy. You need more?
Reminds me of courtesy.
I think you're going to want some more there.
That's the water. And just pour it on the tea and don't leave me there.
Oh, okay. So I can watch your reaction here.
And don't put in that extra tea except after 2-3 minutes. In other words, when the new tea bowl.
Let the water sit.
Ferment sweet tea.
Well, you have a great deal of contact with French here, that's as it should be. This is a question of self-honesty. Why it's so hard to have it, to have some honesty. Apparently on the French side, it's harder to be honest because there's probably some insidious hostility that doesn't want to show itself. So he could write a little piece on that curve, the present edition of the other one. If Quebec becomes a sovereign state, what's the difference? Mm-hmm. And they will still have to have this relation with the rest of Canada, so sovereignty and association.
Are they going to set up border guards at the
border guards?
Ontario?
Except that when you have a confederation, the confederate parts try at least to cooperate. When you have separate nations, inevitably, there are hostilities constantly. The cooperation is much more difficult between independent parts. That's the Balkan states.
Yeah, the Eastern Europe is all exploding.
And it's happening in Eastern Europe, that's right. It's happening again where every single damn little, the Serbians want it, the West want it, the
Croatian.
Yugoslavia is back to four groups.
And as in a recent article in the London Review of Books, it says that this is really out of date. This type of nation, what is the lesson about the ego? And I'm trying to work that out in my mind. I would say in the first place, extreme courtesy to everybody. Try to treat everybody's ego with a kid loves, with very great kindness, because everybody is
part and think about this. Or are we taught to hound and go after more?
Do you know anybody like that? I think we might, and I might too. People who have been disappointed in life, have not realized great hopes, who have learned to say to themselves, well, that's it. I have to be content with what I have, and have become kind of humble, and perhaps slightly defeated, but also, in a sense, resigned and happy. That is the aggressiveness of the ego. The child is visible from the cradle. Yeah. It's a power lust, a power hunger that nature has made each one want. Well, in my life, the kind of thing I love is where a couple of egos are present in the room, like five or six, and they're discussing or talking, or they are writing poems and submitting, and each one is doing some good stuff. Well, every ego is driven to surpass, and each one says, great, that was a pretty good poem, you son of a bitch. It made me very envious that you're also good a poem. You know,
that comes right back, and it's sort of like, and it's not so much fun winning. I think,
you know, if you love the person against whom competing, I'm thinking of playing chess with my son, and he very often defeats me. He's very good. And I'm happy that you beat him. Actually, I like him very much. In the first was kind of, you know, shit, I lost the game, but I can't tell, he was so good that he didn't.
Proud of him and that.
Yes, yeah, so you see, that's probably a rule. That if the one you're competing with or the one in the company is someone you love, you're happy that they are.
And the ego is involved with that. So it's the idea to try and, so you can't, you sort of can't really kill it because it's subconscious, it's at you anyway.
Oh, you'll never get rid of it. That's why you'll become a hypocrite slightly if you're trying to kill it.
So you have to try and persuade it to
work. On the other hand, a saint has succeeded probably in eliminating quite a good deal of the ego.
Mother Teresa,
do you think she's got an ego? I doubt it.
We wonder if she somehow takes delight in these people's misery in some sense, and the fact that she can help them.
There's a deeper analysis. Now, what you are saying,
almost an impossible thing to escape in a way, the fact that she can really be helping these people, and she's very aware of how the world thinks.
Yeah, but there's a thought I was going to say, that it was in the 18th century that La Rochefoucauld discovered this, that even the most altruistic actions are done from an egotistic point of view, that there's ego even behind that. Now, that was one of the stages in which the French rationalist cynics really discovered that ego was behind things. In the 19th century, Nietzsche is the great spokesman for the ego, where he says, assert it. It is the source of the greatest good, you say.
Don't deny yourself, that will cause problems then. But
it's necessary.
Let it out.
Healthy psyche.
But
and
Freud
went
direction.
Along with that too. You see, you learned a lot from Nietzsche.
Yes.
A healthy ego is a healthy self. It's necessary. But we're going to go further than that, aren't we?